guys, my name is Amish Tripathi and I'm the director of the Nehru Centre. The Nehru Centre is the cultural wing of the Indian High Commission in the UK, and we've been in existence for many decades, and we organize wonderful events at this very auditorium, which is in Mayfair in central London. Sadly, as you can see, the auditorium is empty. It has been empty since we were all put into lockdown due to the coronavirus pandemic. But what we Indians believe is that the other side of a crisis is an opportunity. And what we have done at the Nehru Centre is moved all our events online. So now if you attend our online events, every single seat is a VIP seat. Like, you get a front row at our events. No trouble of parking, no trouble of traveling all the way. And most practically all the programs that we would do, like literary discussions and dance performances, musical performances, we are doing them all on our online channels. You can register at for our newsletter at our website, nehrucentre.org.uk. You don't need to write them down. They will be displayed at the bottom of the screen. You can also come to our Facebook page, which is a verified page, the Nehru Centre. You can follow updates on all our events on Twitter as well, the Nehru Centre. That's also a verified account. Or you can come to our YouTube channel. Again, the Nehru Centre. We are nothing if not consistent. I hope you do come to our online channels and enjoy the events that we're putting up for you. Thank you so much for all your love and support. Namaste. Jai Hind.
Namaskar, I'm Vishvesh Negi. I am the acting director of the Nehru Centre London. I am currently working in place of Mr. Amish Tripathi, who is in India. I have been given the responsibility to be your host for today's event. As part of the 151st birth anniversary of Mahatma Gandhiji, the Nehru Centre London is organizing a Gandhi event today, in which the main speaker would be Madam Tara Gandhi Bhattacharjee. Let me take this opportunity to provide you with a short bio profile of Madam. She is a Gandhian scholar, has held the position of Vice-Chairperson of the Gandhi Smriti for nearly 9 years. Madam is also involved with the movement to protect rivers and the environment of the country. She has been involved with this movement, Save the Ganga Movement. For the last 28 years, she has been working with all devotion for the Kasturba Gandhi National Memorial Trust founded by Mahatma Gandhi. She has been appointed as the chairperson of the National Gandhi Museum, New Delhi, from 2019. Ladies and gentlemen, as you all are aware, Mahatma Gandhiji, the father of our nation, his ideas, his values, his teachings have formed an important part of our upbringing, and they guide us on how to live our life the best. His preachings of truth, nonviolence, satyagraha has influenced policymakers, nation states, and especially the youth of this country. I am hopeful that after the conversation today, we would be able to imbibe the values and the principles of Mahatma Gandhiji in our lives and make them more better. With those thoughts, I would now request Madam Tara Gandhi Bhattacharjee to enlighten us through the Gandhi Katha on the lives and on the life and principle of Mahatma Gandhiji. Thank you so much.
My dear sisters and brothers of London, I love your beautiful city, and whenever I go there, it never fails to surprise me with its beauty. I hope I'll have many more chances of visiting this beautiful place. We are concluding the celebration of the 150th anniversary of Gandhi and his wife Kasturba. Concluding the story of Gandhi is not the right word, though, because Gandhi will be there, a reality forever. He was a reality yesterday, he's here today, and he remains forever. And Gandhi today does not belong to India alone or to the family alone, Gandhi belongs to the entire humanity, and it is like a global feature, and everyone is in search of Gandhi. So while talking of Gandhi and Kasturba, I want to first talk about the situation we are together in this world today. We are all together in deep pain for millions and millions of persons across the world who have been faced with unbelievable and immeasurable suffering. I join you in expressing our heartfelt appreciation and gratitude for all who are risking their lives to help and serve the needy and the society. We are together in prayer. The pandemic of coronavirus has shattered the human soul. The cosmic law of justice has pronounced an unprecedented and unexpected fury on the human race in this planet. But this cosmic fury has awakened the damaged and the anguished human soul to another reality of spiritual realization. Once I had the privilege and honor of being in a special audience with His Holiness Pope Francis in the Vatican City. The Pope repeated again and again in 5 different languages, "The Creator always forgives us. What is created never forgets and never forgives. If we hurt a tree, an animal, life, or any nature, they take the revenge. Please protect life around you." He was appealing to the congregation. I have a question. What is development and what is progress? Ruining and killing nature on one side, and on the other side, progressing with concrete jungles and going in for the fastest technology. Is that development? Galloping speed of technology cannot reach the speed of our mind. The mind can travel all over the universe and beyond without losing any time. It is also interesting to note that even with the fastest technology of communication, today's man is feeling isolated more than ever before in the history of humanity. We are living with fear and with lack of trust. Yet it is a fact that the rapidly fast-growing technology is an unbelievable miracle in the history of the society that we are witnessing in our time. But the meaning of development cannot be measured only by the progress of technology. The essence of development is evolution of human mind with compassion for the next human being and every life. Today we are able to understand with great clarity the vision and the message of great philosophers and thinkers of the past and the present. We are all together and in introspection. On a thread of creation, in a global circle, a pilgrimage of silence, seeking in orbit a moment of enlightenment, of peace and truth within and without. We are also in the context of the celebration of 150th anniversary of Mahatma Gandhi and his wife Kasturba. I had the privilege of being very close to Gandhi and Kasturba till I was nearly 14. Gandhi was very close to his sons and grandchildren. Time spent with him was always full of adventure, of learning, and of fun. Little did I realize that I was growing up in an extraordinary era. As an adolescent girl, I was witness to time and transition in the country. Historically, socially, and geographically, the country was changing. As a child, as a little girl, and as an adolescent, I was very close to my grandfather, grandmother, Pandit Nehru, Sardar Patel, Badshah Khan, Maulana Azad, and many stalwarts of history were like members of our own family. I'm not a scholar, certainly not an intellectual, and far from being academic. The way of my understanding of Gandhi is on the basis of my small personal experiences with Gandhi, Kasturba, and that extraordinary era. I have always been inspired by how Bapu maintained his ascetic lifestyle, even in jail. Prayers, meditation, reading, writing, spinning, etc., would start at 3 a.m. Most of the writings by the great freedom fighters were done in jail. Given his thirst for knowledge, Bapuji would always manage to learn some words of a new language. He used to also practice writing with his left hand. According to psychiatrists and health experts today, right-handed people should practice writing with their left hand and vice versa. Such a practice helps us fight many diseases associated with old age. Even in the somber atmosphere of the jailhouse, Bapuji's sense of humor was unforgettable. I still clearly remember Bapuji's charming laughter as he was telling my father that the British government had hung a black cloth around the little courtyard of his small prison enclosure so that people would not be able to see him from outside. He said it so charmingly and with a laughter. In the limited time allotted to us to meet him, Bapuji would put aside his spinning as well as his writing. In jest, but also with the aim to teach us, he would always ask, "Do you practice letter writing? Has your handwriting improved? You must learn Tamil from your mother." Bapuji always stressed on the art of letter writing. In that era, the postcard was an important part of life. In fact, the postcards and letter writing had played the crucial role of Gandhi's entire non-violent crusade against injustice. The letter writing connected all the great minds for the cause, for the non-violent struggle. Once I had written a letter to Bapuji when he was in prison. The letter reached him, of course. The postal system was very good. Bapuji wrote back to me, "I received your letter. It is not nice. Improve your handwriting and write to me again." Angry and hurt, I tore the letter to pieces. I did not realize then how precious a historical document that letter could have been today. I don't think I ever wrote to Bapuji again after that. I lost out on some interesting discourse as a result. There was no exchange of letters with Bapuji later, but I did spend more and more time with him. Sitting next to Gandhiji, one got the vibrations of purity, love, and compassion. Even if there was no conversation, and when Gandhiji remained silent, this happens with great pure people with their purity of mind, that you don't have to talk to them. The vibrations touch you. There is a very amusing anecdote that I would like to share. Once when we came out of Bapuji's room to go for the prayer meeting, I noticed a foreign guest in the crowd who was approaching Bapuji in eagerness. Bapuji had probably been waiting for him. He stopped to greet British guest. The guest was Sir Stafford Cripps. He had come to India on a special mission related to India's independence. But I was completely oblivious to the historical context of this special visit. My talking about these historical and political contexts and issues would mean venturing into an unfamiliar territory. But I had to narrate a rather amusing episode. Bapuji introduced me to Sir Stafford Cripps with the pride of a grandfather. "Please meet my granddaughter, daughter of my youngest son." How do you do? Saying so, Sir Stafford Cripps extended his hand. Till then, I had never shaken hands with an Englishman. I could not speak the language in a natural way. In the excitement of shaking hands with an Englishman, I not only thought it necessary to answer him in English, but also thought it to be my prerogative to do so. "Oh," I said, "I had fever yesterday. I am feeling better today." And then I continued, "Tomorrow I will go to school, but I'm not sure. If there is no ache in my body, my mother will allow me to go to the school. A doctor will also visit me." It was too long an answer for a greeting in response to "how do you do." I took it in the sense of "how are you?" It was time for prayers, and Bapuji was looking at his watch. His responsibility to the nation was above everything else. Even in a historic moment of our country, Gandhi was serious to his rigorous daily routine. But his young granddaughter's foolishness became unbearable for him. And momentarily forgetting his esteemed guest, he took me aside and explained to me, "Tara, when someone asks you, 'how do you do?' in English, you only say, 'how do you do?' You should not talk of your health then. They are not asking about your health." I felt hurt and rather embarrassed. When I got home, I told my mother, "What kind of a language is this? When someone asks you, 'how are you?' shouldn't we talk about ourselves?" Bapuji's reprimand had rankled me so much, because concern for others' health was of utmost importance to Gandhi. This new revelation about foreign customs seemed totally contrary to our culture. But today, that memory is always a source of amusement. Once there was a conversation about the kitchen. "Do you know how to boil water?" Bapuji suddenly asked me. "Yes, Bapuji, why won't a girl of my age know how to boil water?" I should have said that I did not know any household work. But sitting on high moral ground, my effort to impress my grandfather was a reflection of my immaturity. Bapuji said, explaining the basics to me, "You have to get the fire ready before boiling wet water. Do you know how to?" In those days, there was no gas stoves in Delhi. I failed before my grandfather. I was his son's young, spoiled daughter. But Gandhi loved me very much. Whatever he told us would be accompanied by his trademark laughter. One day, Bapuji said to me, "Your father is an editor in a newspaper, and you must be getting a lot of letters at home. Don't throw away these envelopes. Open them and make a sheet of the creed sites for me to write on." My brothers and I were highly motivated and began to collect the envelopes for him. We split them open, put the creed sites up, made a pile, and showed it to my father. My father trimmed those papers and said, "Bapuji likes everything to be done neatly." There was a lesson in this. A lesson to use time wisely and to recycle waste products, to complete a task properly, and learning the joys of working in a group. In the entire episode, I saw my father's understanding of and adoration for his own father. When we took that neatly pile to Bapuji, he was thrilled. His smile was a reward for us. Taking the neatly trimmed envelopes, he smiled and said, "I can see your father's contribution in this." There was a twinkle in his eyes. Why won't a father recognize the result of his teachings to his son? I wondered, and I asked. Mahatma Gandhi could not have been complete without the spiritual strength of Kasturba. The same age as her husband, Kasturba was born in Porbandar in 1869. Married in 1882, Kastur and Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi were 13 years old. Belonging to the Baniya caste of Gujarat, the parents of both, the bride and the bridegroom, were important noble families of Porbandar. Kastur was a witness to the extraordinary mind of an idealistic teenager and to all the experiments of truth conducted by her husband throughout his life. She became a full partner in all the political, social, and spiritual struggles of Mahatma Gandhi. According to Gandhi, Matri Shakti, the mother power, is the strongest force in creation. He discovered the same significance of mother power, Matri Shakti, in Kasturba that had inspired him by his mother, Putlibai. Inherent in man as well as woman and in all forms of life, Matri Shakti, truth, compassion, and courage are inseparable from the philosophy of non-violence of Gandhi. Mahatma Gandhi decided that the indomitable yet gentle spirit of Kasturba would best be honored by reaching out to the needy women and children of the villages across rural India. This vision was in harmony with Sarvodaya. Sarvodaya is a reawakening of consciousness of man to live in harmony with nature and all life. Mahatma Gandhi belongs to the entire world, and his life, philosophy, and mind will remain a constant subject of analysis, veneration, as well as strong criticism. There is a global search of Gandhi today. Truth and non-violence as experienced, experimented, and lived by Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi. I wonder if at any time in the history of humanity, the philosophical and moral concepts of truth and compassion have been a subject of such collective and conscious celebration throughout the world. We have to understand the non-dualism of Gandhian philosophy. In honor of Gandhi and Kasturba, let us look at the entire Mother Earth with sanctity, where there is respect for all faiths. Tolerance is not the right word. It is very condescending. It is only with deep respect that we should understand the other's philosophy. There are mosques, temples, gurudwaras, and places of worship and meditation. And all stand on Mother Earth, which is the greatest place of worship. The 2nd October, the birth anniversary of Mahatma Gandhi, has been declared as the International Day of Nonviolence by the United Nations. In contrast with the worldwide reality of consciousness of nonviolence, there are also the terrifying contradictions of the reality of appalling and environmental pollution, horrifying human violence, and terror with the threat of biological, chemical, and nuclear weapons, and a global chain of sentimental fear. Yet the strongest force is inherent in truth, courage, and compassion that are the desperate need of today. The philosophy and the practice of non-violence and peace are needed for the very survival of life and environment today. Once I had spent some very precious time with His Holiness the Dalai Lama. His Holiness is so charming that one can be natural and oneself before him. "Your Holiness," I said, "don't you think that the children, girl child as well as the boy child, should be brought up with compassion so that they grow up with examples of compassion in their life?" "Yes," he said in a charming and convincing way, We should set examples, compassion before them. But compassion alone is not enough. They should have a sense of responsibility for the society around them. The shortest way to the future of our dreams can be achieved only by giving the right education and examples set by us for the children and the youth of the country. The life of every human being is based on the experiences of childhood. The memory of experiences of childhood is never forgotten by any human being. Let us not forget that most terrorists and violent people have faced brutal childhood. We must give the right education and examples of compassion and responsibility to our children and the youth. The best gift to a child is a best memory, is a beautiful memory for his future. The right education and examples are the most urgent need for the future responsible citizens of the world. There is a proverb, if you take care of today, tomorrow will take care of itself. It is through education alone that we can begin to go ahead towards a future where the human mind is without violence and the environment is without pollution. What we need today is a message of Sarvodaya, the reawakening of the soul in harmony with nature and life. Children and youth of today will make our future. Let us work towards a future where the human mind is without violence and the environment without pollution.
Thank you very much, madam, for your outstanding thoughtful views about Gandhiji's today on describing Gandhi Katha through your own words. I hope distinguished viewers must have liked it, and we are very much blessed to have you here today. Following with, we would like to highlight the glimpse of an exhibition of Dandi March. Hope you may like it. Distinguished guest, hope you must have liked it today's event. We are blessed by the presence of Madam Tara Bhattacharjee, renowned Gandhian scholar, describing Gandhi Katha through the platform of the Nehru Centre. And she has mesmerized us by her wordings about Gandhiji and his ideologies. I am also thankful to Mr. Vishwesh Negi, Minister Political in the High Commission of India, Acting Director, the Nehru Center, welcoming Madam Tara Gandhi Bhattacharjee and delivering its welcome remarks. Thank you very much, for sparing your valuable time. I am specially thankful to the viewers joining Nehru Center platform. Your cooperation for our events is values us a lot. In the near future, following 151st Gandhi anniversary, the Nehru Center has planned showcasing important exhibitions about Gandhi and his ideology. You could explore these exhibitions through Facebook, YouTube, MailChimp of Nehru Centre. Sites are available. Hope you may like it. Thank you very much for joining today.